In the gut, during protein digestion by pancreatic enzymes, amino acid elimination and urea degradation by gut bacteria, there is massive release of ammonia as a byproduct. And this ammonia freely absorbed into the mesenteric veins and then drained into portal vein, and by portal vein ammonia is delivered to the liver where it undergoes detoxification. Liver is playing the key role in blood ammonia regulation because it has a tremendous detoxification capacity. The main detoxification mechanism is by urea formation through urea cycle, when two ammonia molecules are extracted from the blood and converted into one urea molecule. Through this mechanism, liver can extract from the blood approximately 80% of ammonia. By the way, liver is the only site where urea is synthesized in human body. In addition to urea cycle, hepatocytes also have glutamine synthetase pathway of ammonia detoxification. The principle is that glutamate binds ammonia and converts into glutamine. This reaction catalyzed by glutamine synthetase enzyme. So after liver detoxification, blood ammonia substantially decreases. Aside liver, skeletal muscles also have the ability to detoxify ammonia because they also have the glutamine synthetase enzyme, and detoxification of blood ammonia in skeletal muscles became very important in condition when liver function is significantly impaired, for example in liver failure. And ammonia that is remaining in blood after these two detoxification stages have the ability to cross blood-brain barrier. And brain also have the ability to detoxify ammonia, and this ammonia detoxification occurs in astrocytes, because they also have glutamine synthetase enzyme. So in astrocytes, glutamate binds ammonia molecule and converts into glutamine. So what happens in liver failure? As an example, let's take cirrhosis with chronic liver failure. First of all, in cirrhosis there is decrease in quantity of hepatocytes, and because hepatocytes have two major pathways of ammonia detoxification that in normal condition provides detoxification of 80 to 90% of ammonia, the decrease in hepatocytes quantity leads to a substantial decrease in detoxification with massive rise in blood ammonia level. Also in cirrhosis, portal hypertension develops with development of portal systemic shunts that can aggravate hyperammonemic state. Because formation of new or deletion of pre-existing anastomosis between portal and systemic venous system facilitates shunting of blood away from the liver into systemic venous system without liver detoxification. And of course, if blood bypass liver, there is no detoxification, so blood ammonia level will increase. Also, because in cirrhosis, catabolism prevails, the muscle mass decreases, and lost muscle tissue replaced by adipose tissue, this process called myosteatosis. The problem is that adipose tissue don't have glutamine synthetase enzyme, thereby it cannot detoxify ammonia. So myosteatosis results in decrease in detoxification capacity that lead to rise in blood ammonia level. So with decrease in detoxification capacity, the blood ammonia level became significantly elevated. And ammonia at high concentration has the ability to penetrate from blood into particularly all organs. But the most sensitive organ to hyperammonemia is brain, because brain have huge metabolic rate. Also, chronic liver failure affects intestinal homeostasis and causes increase in gut permeability and dysbiosis. The combination of these two factors leads to bacterial translocations that lead to excessive synthesis of pro-inflammatory cytokines and development of chronic systemic inflammatory state. In addition to this, in cirrhosis due to hepatocyte necrosis, there is increase in production of reactive oxygen species, as well as decrease in liver capacity to synthesize antioxidants because most of antioxidants in normal states are produced by hepatocytes. And if we summarize chronic inflammatory state with excessive production of pro-inflammatory cytokines and increase in the production of reactive oxygen species due to hepatocyte necrosis and also decrease in liver capacity to synthesize antioxidants, all of these factors cause massive oxidant stress, and massive oxidant stress affects primarily endothelial cells that line blood-brain barrier, and this leads to impaired barrier function with increase in barrier permeability that leads to significant increase in ammonia level in the brain. So there is substantial increase in ammonia level in the brain, and hyperammonemia affects brain in two major ways. First, by affecting astrocytes, and second, by disruption of neurotransmission. Astrocytes are the primary target of ammonia just because they have glutamine synthetase. Astrocytes sense that there is increase in ammonia level in the brain, and they activate glutamine synthetase pathway of ammonia detoxification. Glutamate binds ammonia and converts into glutamine. This results in accumulation of glutamine inside the astrocytes, and the higher the ammonia level, the more glutamine accumulates. and this neuroproduced glutamine causes neurotoxicity by two major ways. First of all, directly, because glutamine is osmotically active substance, and because in astrocytes there is progressive accumulation of glutamine, fluid is going by osmotic gradient into astrocytes, and this results in astrocyte swelling and developing of cerebral edema. And also indirectly, because accumulated glutamine must be degraded, and its degradation occurs in mitochondria by hydrolysis, and this hydrolysis results in the production of free ammonia and generation of reactive oxygen species that cause mitochondrial dysfunction and also triggers inflammatory response. So how hyperammonemia affects neurotransmission? The mechanism is that in chronic liver disease, and especially in cirrhosis, detoxification function is impaired, and decrease in detoxification leads to increase in blood ammonia level and also to increase in blood aromatic amino acids, as tyrosine, phenylalanine, and tryptophan. They're called aromatic because they have an aromatic ring in their structure, and these aromatic amino acids play a crucial role in hepatic encephalopathy. The problem is that these aromatic amino acids can cross blood-brain barrier through large neutral amino acids transporter, and when they cross blood-brain barrier, the level of cerebral amino acids increase, and this leads to an excessive synthesis of false neurotransmitters as tyramine and octopamine. These false neurotransmitters can displace true neurotransmitters from presynaptic vesicles, thereby disrupting neuron-neuron signaling. For example, when phenylalanine crosses blood-brain barrier by hydroxylation, he converts into tyrosine, and tyrosine by decarboxylation is converted into tyramine, and tyramine can be converted by hydroxylation into octopamine or dopamine. And dopamine can be converted into norepinephrine and epinephrine. Dopamine, norepinephrine, and epinephrine are true neurotransmitters that in normal condition transported to secretory vesicles and secreted from presynaptic neuron and act on postsynaptic neuron. And what happens in cirrhosis is that because there is increase in aromatic amino acids level in the brain, particularly in phenylalanine level, this causes rise in tyrosine, that subsequently causes rise in tyramine, so there is rise in precursor of normal neurotransmitters, and the reason why is this depicted in formulas, because you can see how similar the structure of these substances. For example, tyramine and dopamine, or octopamine and norepinephrine, and because their structure are very similar, tyramine and octopamine can displace true neurotransmitters as dopamine, norepinephrine, and epinephrine from secretory vesicles, and instead, for example, dopamine, tyramine is secreted from presynaptic neuron, and he acts differently, thereby disrupting neuron-neuron signaling. That's why they're called false neurotransmitters, because they have similar structure, but they act differently compared to the true neurotransmitters. And cerebral edema and impaired neurotransmission results in hepatic encephalopathy symptoms as rigidity, hyperreflexia, asterixis, and even altered level of consciousness.